Our subcommittee will come to order. Good afternoon. Thank you all for joining us. I would like to welcome our witnesses, Lieutenant General Terry Roebling, Deputy Commandant for Aviation U.S. Marine Corps, Rear Admiral William Moran, Director, Air Warfare Division, U.S. Navy, Mr. Richard Gilpin, Deputy Assistant Secretary of the Navy Air Programs Office, Major General William Crosby, Program Executive Officer, Aviation, U.S. Army, Major General Noel Jones, Director, Operational Capability Requirements, U.S. Air Force, and Major General Robert Kane, Director, Global Reach Programs, U.S. Air Force. Thank you all for being here and for your service to our nation. The use of helicopters has dramatically changed warfare doctrine from the time of their introduction during the Korean War, followed by development prior to Vietnam, used during Vietnam as a mobility platform, and current rotorcraft aviation operations. The helicopter is now a platform of maneuver used for multi-missions to include resupply, medical evaluation, reconnaissance, air assault, and attack operations. The U.S. Armed Forces currently have approximately 7,000 helicopters. Operations in Iraq and Afghanistan have put an even greater reliance on rotorcraft support as a result of improvised explosive devices, which have restricted ground movement. Based on current planned force structure reductions, the demand for rotorcraft capability will even be more critical in the future. Maintaining a healthy fleet of rotorcraft equates to the total force having the ability to cover the wide area battle space as referenced in the National Security Strategy. The purpose of this hearing is to get an update from each service as to the condition of their respective current rotorcraft fleet and plans for future upgrades and modernization. In addition to various platform updates, the committee hopes to learn how the services are utilizing research and development dollars to develop the next generation of rotary wing systems and subsystems. And finally, given the likelihood that there will be a continued or even greater dependence on rotorcraft in the future, and the likelihood that rotorcraft will have to operate in greater threat environments than they currently do in Afghanistan, the committee expects to learn what each service is doing in regards to aircraft survivability equipment and how they are working together to maximize resources. Again, I thank all of you for your service to our country and for being here. I look forward to your testimony. And now to my good friend from Texas, the ranking member, Mr. Reyes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And let me add my welcome to all of you. Thanks for being here and thanks for your service. Today's hearing on DoD rotorcraft programs is the first Tactical Airland Forces hearing specifically covering these programs, I believe, in many years. And based on the budget request for fiscal year 2013, a hearing is definitely warranted for several reasons. One major issue is the cost of these rotorcraft programs and how they impact other areas of military service budgets. The Army 2013 request, for example, includes $4.3 billion for procurement of upgraded and new rotorcraft, including Blackhawk, Chinook, Apache, Kiowa, and Lakota helicopters. By comparison, the Army's request for weapons and tracked combat vehicles in 2013 is only $1.5 billion, less than half as much. The Marine Corps request for rotorcraft programs totals $1.4 billion for just two major programs, the new AH-1Z and the UH-1Y helicopters and CH-53K development programs. If one adds the V-22 program to that amount, the total for the Marine Corps' request is more than $3 billion. This $3 billion total exceeds the Marine Corps' entire ground equipment procurement budget, which is about $2.5 billion. The other two services have somewhat lower requests, with the Navy's request at $1.2 billion and the Air Force coming in somewhere around $500 million. If one totals up the service request for rotorcraft programs, you get around $9 billion, with the vast majority of that funding being procurement of new or upgraded aircraft. So it is clear that rotorcraft programs are a priority for all the services, and in particular, of course, the Army and the Marine Corps. Overall, the strong investment in updating and replacing the services of rotorcraft fleets, I think, is a very good thing. However, one concern that I also have is how skewed this funding request may be in favor of production of new manned rotorcraft as opposed to research and development of new rotorcraft for future use. This imbalance, in part, the result of termination of almost every new manned rotorcraft program DOD has tried to start in recent years. As an example, the Army has little funding for R&D of new rotorcraft after the termination of the Comanche and armed reconnaissance helicopter programs. The program intended to follow those two efforts remains mired in seemingly endless analysis of alternatives with, from our perspective, no clear path forward. Likewise, the Air Force canceled the SAR-X Combat Rescue Helicopter Program in 2009, and this year canceled its program to replace the aging U-1 Huey helicopters. Both have yet to restart. The Navy continues to struggle with defining requirements for the new presidential helicopter almost 3 years after termination of the VH-71 program, again in 2009. Only the Marine Corps has a large-scale and so far successful R&D program underway with a CH-53K heavy lift helicopter program. Another concern that I have is the lack of commonality in some mission areas between our respective services. The Army, Navy, and Air Force all fly variants of the UH-60 helicopter, which produces significant savings in both production and support cost. The Marine Corps, in contrast, is fielding rotorcraft unique and DOD, including the upgraded AH-1Z Cobra and the UH-1Y Huey, and of course the CH-53E Super Stallion. This does not mean that the Marine Corps programs should be stopped or reduced, but I do believe that it does raise the issue of how in the future, at least for the next generation of rotorcraft, DOD can better achieve truly joint solutions. Finally, with respect to the unmanned rotorcraft, there are several promising research and development efforts underway, with the Navy and Marine Corps leading the way with the MQ-8 and the cargo resupply unmanned aerial system. While funding for these efforts is relatively small at this point compared to our manned rotorcraft programs, they could be important waypoints towards future efforts. So, with that, Mr. Chairman, I look forward to the testimony from our guest, and I yield back the balance of my time.
Thank you. Without objection, all witness-prepared statements will be included in the hearing record. It's my understanding that there will be three oral statements, one representing the Navy and Marine Corps, second, the Army, and third, the Air Force. The first testimony is from General Roebling, representing the Navy and Marine Corps.
Chairman Bartlett and Ranking Member Reyes, distinguished members of the subcommittee, it is our honor to appear before you today to discuss the Department of the Navy's rotorcraft modernization programs. Testifying with me today are Mr. Rich Gilpin, Deputy Assistant Secretary of the Navy for Air Programs, and Rear Admiral William Moran, the Navy's Director of Air Warfare. And as you've stated, Mr. Chairman, I'll keep our oral remarks brief and I'll submit our combined statement for the record, including the questions requested by the subcommittee. I'd like to begin by thanking the members of the subcommittee for your support of our programs and our Marines and sailors. 11 years into sustained combat operations, we continue to see Marines and sailors perform magnificently. They could not perform their missions without the tools of their craft. The vertical lift capability of the department's rotorcraft platforms is one of the key enablers in combat. Last year, we embraced our past history as Naval Aviation celebrated its centennial. This year, Marine Corps Aviation is doing the same. It was nearly 66 years ago, in 1946, when Major Armand Delalio was designated as the first Marine helicopter pilot. Our workhorse of the fleet, the CH-53, flew its first flight in October of 1964. The CH-53 Delta has recently flown its last flight on U.S. soil, but it continues to provide expeditionary heavy lift as it has since its beginning in combat. This final deployment will retire those aircraft in place in Afghanistan later this summer. While the requirement to accomplish our missions have not abated, we recognize that today our nation faces immense challenges. The budget reductions necessitated by the Budget Control Act remind us of the unquestioned need to be good stewards of our resources and to be prudent in our spending. We continue to actively manage our current rotary craft inventory. The MV-22 cost per flight hour decreased 13% in fiscal year 2011, and the program received the prestigious David Packard Excellence in Acquisition Award, which recognized exemplary performance and innovation acquiring and delivering products and capabilities to the warfighter. We will begin our AH-1 Zulu build new procurement strategy in fiscal year 2013, which eliminates the AH-1W remanufacture process and enables a faster recovery from the USMC's current attack helicopter shortfall. The VH-3 Delta and the VH-60 November continue to provide seamless vertical lift for the President and the Vice President of the United States, while the Presidential Helicopter Replacement Aircraft effort focuses on completing the update to the analysis of alternatives and continues to develop an acquisition strategy that targets affordability, cost control, and reduction of risk prior to the awarding of any major contracts. We must persist in modernizing and recapitalizing our naval aviation forces by the most affordable means possible. With your assistance, we are leveraging our buying power with successful multi-year procurements on the V-22 and H-60, achieving substantial procurement cost savings. The H-1 upgrades program has seen aircraft delivered ahead of the contracted schedule and on budget. We have increased our lethality with such low-cost weapons as the Advanced Precision Kill Weapon System 2. Upgrades to the MH-60 Romeo and MH-60 Sierra have significantly improved the anti-submarine warfare and surface warfare capabilities of the fleet. Still in development is the CH-53K, which will have nearly triple the lift capability of the current CH-53 Echo. The CH-53K program was recently awarded the Robert L. Pinckney Award from the American Helicopter Society International. This award is given in recognition of notable achievement in manufacturing research and development of rotorcraft or rotorcraft components. Finally, the Department of the Navy is looking toward the future, and we are actively participating with the other services in the DoD-led Future Vertical Lift Initiative. I'd like to thank you once again for the opportunity to speak here today, and we welcome your questions on the Department of the Navy's rotorcraft modernization programs.
Thank you. Now General Crosby from the Army.
Good afternoon, sir. Chairman Bartlett, Ranking Member Reyes, and distinguished members of the subcommittee, thank you for calling this hearing. I'm pleased to be here today to discuss Army aviation and welcome this opportunity to testify before you. On behalf of our great Army, I appreciate the tremendous and ongoing support this committee has provided to our soldiers stationed around the world. I know you all will be able to agree that our soldiers have performed magnificently and their families have sacrificed much for our nation over this past 10 years. You specifically asked that the Army address several concerns on the Army aviation modernization. Army aviation is without a doubt the best in the world, employing cutting-edge technology that provides an invaluable capability, making it indispensable on the battlefield. This capability is only as good as the aviation soldiers who operate and maintain these great systems worldwide. Our relationship with the ground force is the best that it's ever been in Army aviation's history. Achieving such a high level of professional excellence took years of hard work by a new generation of air and ground warriors who fully respect the warfighting accomplishments of each other. It is our dedication to supporting the ground commander that helped to establish a collaborative environment among the various members of the aviation enterprise over the past several years and will serve as the foundation for our future success. The Army recognizes that in our current fiscal environment, we must share in the responsibility of finding new and innovative ways of acquiring and sustaining our Army aviation weapons systems smarter, faster, cheaper, and more effectively. As such, we have taken a proactive approach to aviation modernization plan that ensures the balanced, long-range approach. We recognize that we must adapt our plan while avoiding the natural tendency to cut our investment programs to meet short-term mandates. Our plan accepts risk in some modification improvements, minimizes the impacts to our industrial base by preserving our multi-year contracts, and increases the production plan by 3 to 5 years in the long term, which means we would reduce quantities in the near term. We have done this to preserve our science and technology investments in a future vertical lift, maintain our path to address the deficiencies in the Scout mission area, and continue our procurement and modernization of our current platforms and our unmanned aircraft systems. My written testimony outlines in more detail our plan in maintaining and sustaining Army aviation and modernization plans and addresses your specific concerns. With the current resource environment, we are going to have to take the best solution we can with the best potential for success without compromising safety, identify what those impacts are early, and determine the best course of action to give our soldiers what they need at a price that we can afford. As our Army cares for its aging fleet, we will continue to support the development and execution of a new investment strategy that will provide for new platforms ready to field in the 2025 timeframe and beyond. The Joint Future Vertical Lift aircraft is an integral part of our long-range plan and part of our balanced approach to maintain our investments. 2030 is the aim point for a new system to replace our aging fleets, and our initial effort will be focused on the attack and utility mission areas, which comprises about 75% of our current fleet. Science and technology investments today in subsystems like the Improved Turbine Engine Program and the other identified enabling technologies are critical to maintain our planned schedule. In continuing to modernize our fleet, our investments have produced a healthy inventory of aircraft that are still high in demand in Afghanistan, Iraq, and other places in the world where our soldiers have answered our nation's call. We will need a faster and more survivable aircraft after 2030 to remain effective. Additionally, we continue to execute our multi-year contracts, which have gained our taxpayers significant savings over the prices that would have resulted in the Army awarded single-year contracts. Army aviation programs and their foundations are solid, and we have a modernization strategy for the future. Our aircraft and equipment are the best America can provide and have displayed readiness and flying hour op-tempo rates that far surpassed expectations. More importantly, we have answered the calls to integrate our capabilities with various combined arms teams, sustaining forces, and joint agencies. The fiscal year 2013 President's budget is supportive and representative of Army aviation priorities. While we desire to field our modernized aircraft as quickly as possible, a balance among other Army priorities has been accomplished in this fiscal year 2013 budget request. Your committee has been very supportive of Army aviation budget requests in the past. I am confident you will conclude the Army has optimized an aviation modernization given the fiscal realities within the Army's top-line budget. Again, the credit for Army aviation's success and continued support from senior leaders belongs to the soldiers on the ground who will always be our utmost priority. Whatever we do, we cannot allow our tremendous relationship in supporting the Ground Force Commander to degrade. It is this strong relationship that will be the lens by which we look towards the future and the benchmark by which we will measure success. As we move ahead, Army aviation will continue to ensure we reduce the burden on the soldier. The next several years will be pivotal for Army aviation. The resources provided to the Army to conduct aviation operations while modernizing for the next generation of aviation capabilities will determine the Army's ability to continue to accomplish its mission and be postured to meet future commitments. To execute these plans, we need your continued leadership and support and provide full, timely, and sustained funding so we will be ready for current and future challenges. I'm ready to address any questions you may have, sir. Thank you.
Thank you. And finally, we have General Kane from the Air Force.
Chairman Bartlett, Ranking Member Reyes, and distinguished members of the subcommittee, thank you for the opportunity to update you on key Air Force rotorcraft acquisition programs and modernization efforts. I would like to briefly highlight our special operations, personal recovery, nuclear security, and continuity of government missions and platforms. U.S. Special Operations Command uses the CV-22 Osprey to provide long-range insertion, extraction, and resupply of special operations forces in hostile, denied, or politically sensitive airspace. In order to successfully meet its CV-22 taskings, the Air Force continues to fully support the program of record of 50 aircraft. The current CV-22 fleet stands at 23 aircraft, with the final buy of 7 aircraft scheduled in fiscal years 13 and 14. Declaration of full operational capability will be made following the delivery of the last CV-22 in fiscal year 16. Under the current fiscal constraints, it is important to note that the CV-22's capabilities, reliability, and availability are increasing, while operating costs are decreasing. Future modifications and improvements to the CV-22 will make the aircraft even more effective, reliable, and cost-efficient. For example, we have begun CV-22 Block 20 baseline production, as well as retrofit modifications to improve operational safety and effectiveness. Notably, these enhancements will improve line-of-sight and beyond line-of-sight communication systems, terrain and crew situational awareness capabilities, and defensive systems. In terms of current operations and sustainment, our five deployed CV-22s executed 635 sorties and 1,391 hours between May of 11 and January 12, with an almost 75% mission-capable rate. This includes some recent engine time-on-wing improvements that have increased time between engine removals by 173%. Beyond improved capability, this translates into an estimated $16 million in savings per year. Additionally, the Joint Program Office is investigating modifications to the engine inlet geometry, engine blade coatings, and the high-power turbine case design to further improve engine time on wing. While the CV-22 aircraft procurement phase nears completion, we are moving to address HH-60G fleet availability issues. Our HH-60G combat search and rescue platform is a low-density, high-demand asset. During the past 10 years, our heroic crews have rescued over 12,000 military and civilian personnel. This past year, HH-60G crews performed 16 combat search and rescue missions and over 2,100 casualty evacuation missions. This high demand has taken a toll. Only 99 of the original 112 aircraft still exist. Of those 99, only 93 are currently flyable. Major structural cracks have been found on 66 of the 99 aircraft, with 49 sustaining battle damage in the last 2 years. Aircraft availability is approximately 60% and expected to decrease to 50% by 2015 due to continued component obsolescence and structural issues. The Air Force is taking a three-step approach to address this shortfall. First, we are modifying the existing HH-60G helicopters to keep them viable until the Air Force can fully recapitalize the fleet. Second, the Air Force has implemented the Operational Loss Replacement Program to return the HH-60G fleet to numbers capable of meeting our operational requirements. This is only a temporary bridge to a final solution, which is to replace the entire fleet. To this end, the Air Force released a draft request for proposal for a full and open competition on 16 March of this year, with the final RFP planned for release in May. Contract award is planned for spring of 13, with initial operational capability in 2018. With these combined efforts, the Air Force will be able to maintain its commitment to personnel recovery, a moral imperative for supporting our men and women on the front lines. The Air Force also has two other critical vertical lift missions: National Capital Region Support and Nuclear Security. The current UH-1N fleet, which entered the Air Force in 1970, cannot fully meet the requirements of these missions, lacking sufficient range, speed, payload, endurance, survivability, and number of aircraft. The 2013 President budget terminated the Common Vertical Lift Support Platform program, which was intended to replace the UH-1N fleet. Until a long-term replacement is possible, the Air Force will consider other strategies to mitigate aircraft safety and capability gaps. In the near term, we are evaluating safety and capability improvements, specifically the installation of crashworthy seats and night vision compatible cockpits. In addition to these modifications, we are considering upgrades to training systems that would lower training costs, decrease the UH-1N flying hour requirement, and hopefully extend the useful life of these airframes. Finally, the Air Force is pursuing the transfer and appropriate modifications of up to 22 UH-1Ns from the Marine Corps while we develop a long-term solution. Thank you for the opportunity to address the subcommittee. I appreciate your strong support for the Air Force and our rotorcraft programs, and I look forward to answering your questions.
Thank you all very much for your service and your testimony. As is my practice, I will reserve my questions till last. Mr. Reyes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank you, gentlemen, for your testimony. And, having had the opportunity to be at the initial stages of the rotorcraft, the helicopter, being used in combat in Vietnam, this is an area that I am very much personally interested in. And so it's hard for me, based on what we're understanding from the committee, to see that to one degree or another, the services seem to lack a clear understanding or idea of what they want for the next generation of rotorcraft. As a result, there have been numerous delays in the getting new rotorcraft R&D programs on track, with, I'm being told, the last five major service programs being terminated. Those were the Comanche, the VH-71, the ARH, the CSAR-X, and the CVL-SP. So the questions I have regarding this are, why have we seen so many failures in the new rotorcraft R&D efforts? What is each of the services doing to better define what they will need or what they will want, what kind of capabilities you will want for future operations, and what specific R&D investments are each of you prepared to make in order to better understand the rotorcraft technology of the future? So if any or all of you are willing to take a shot at that, I would appreciate it.
Sir, I'll take the first shot at that. So thanks for that question. I think you know the Marine Corps, we're into our future vertical lift programs right now. We're into them. And we started 10 to 12 years ago starting to downsize the Marine Corps type model series, both fixed wing and helicopter, into, you know, six or seven type model series. We're flying aircraft right now, the CH-46, the H-3, that are over 40 years old in some cases, still flying, over 40. So we buy those on a 20-year or 30-year program, and we've stretched them to 40 years. And in some cases, the CH-46 is at 80% readiness levels. Right now, our CH-53 is in 2014 will be, the Echo will be 30 years old. Some of those aircraft will fly another 10 years. We'll require that to do that until we get the 53K online. So you're asking me about our future vertical lift. That is our future vertical lift, heavy vertical lift, is the CH-53K that we expect once we get IOC'd and get their full eight squadrons, that we'll probably be flying that aircraft another 40 years. We've taken the UH-1 November, which very old aircraft, and the Whiskey, and bought the looking to procure the Yankee and Zulu. The UH-1 November, when I went to OIF-1 with General Amos as the wing commander, and I was his assistant, and then Major General Mattis was the first division commander. When General Mattis wanted a route recon aircraft to route recon his area, I couldn't put him in a UH-1 aircraft. If I put two Marines in the back with 50 cal machine guns, I didn't even have enough room for a nice chest for cold drinks. And so we had to stick him in a CH-46. You can imagine that made him pretty happy. So we're getting to the end of the life of those aircraft, and the monies that we put into both R&D, in this case the H-1 this year, $31 million in R&D to upgrade those aircraft and continue to buy them. And as you pointed out, $824 million to buy at least the 15 Yankees and the 13 Zulus that we're going to buy in this fit-up. And, of course, we do have $606 million across the fit-up in R&D for the CH-53K, which we're hoping to IOC in fiscal year 19. So while we are looking forward, I think the Marine Corps is in its future vertical lift right now. We are participating in OSD's future vertical lift program. We are putting money toward that with the rest of the services as we look ahead to aircraft that are coming off the shelf that may provide technologies that provide us faster aircraft, always looking to go faster, carry more people with less cost and those kind of things. And so I think the answer to that, at least for the Marine Corps, is we are involved.
The 46 is a Seanite, right?
That's correct, sir.
Yeah. When I got to Vietnam and March of 67, the Marines were flying CH-34s, the big radial engine lumbering. So that's why we are very much interested in making sure we have these programs that will advance our capabilities into and turn R&D programs into rotorcraft that would provide the needs of future Marines, sailors, Army, and Air Force. So, anybody else want to comment on that?
Yes, sir. Wanted to thank you for your question relative to presidential helicopter. Wanted to give you a sense of where we're going with that. You're right when you mentioned that getting clarity on requirements is probably critical to what we need to do, and probably one of the shortcomings we faced as we faced the challenge on the VH-71 program. So we are taking some time to make sure that we get the requirements well understood, well coordinated between what's required for the Marines that operate those helicopters, as well as our customer, the White House in this case, and working very hard to do that. Our analysis of alternatives is nearly complete. In the meantime, we're sustaining the current fleet of helicopters, making some improvements to those, updated communication suite, updated vulnerability improvements and the like, and those technologies will be used to as a starting point when we go into the VXX program. So we've developed a acquisition strategy taking advantage of leveraging that new technology into developing the future helicopter, and we should have a solution that's quicker to service and at an affordable price.
Sorry, I'd like to pile on to that if I could. During your time in Vietnam, we were flying the same CH-47s that you saw there. We're still flying them today. So they've been upgraded a little bit thanks to y'all's help, but we're still flying them. We're looking at this in kind of a balanced approach. You know, the normal tendency in a constrained environment is to cut your investments. And I think your comments have shown or reemphasized to us what we already believe, that you've got to balance, look at it as a balanced approach, because if you cut off your investments 10 years down the road, we have no new program. So we're looking to, if you will, sustain what we have currently today to modernize, which is more of a challenge today than in the past because technology is turning over so fast. And then the third one is to put those S&T dollars towards developing that long-range plan. My Marine Corps brothers mentioned the future vertical lift. There's a study that has been done. I know y'all are anxiously awaiting the release of that. Our Vice Chairman of the Joint Chiefs has it on his desk now. Then it'll go to the DEPSEC DEF for approval and then release to you. It lays out a roadmap for all of us, the services together, looking forward. And it identifies kind of a scalable architecture of rotary wing or future vertical lift platforms, a reconnaissance or a light, a medium, which is an attack utility, a third is kind of a cargo heavy lift, and then the fourth would be an ultra. So a scalable where you can have similar technologies across the powertrain in those systems. The one that we've elected to go after first for the best return on investment, we're the biggest parade on rotary wing in the Army, but 75% of my fleet is in the attack utility variant. So what that means is, in a limited budget environment, that means we're going to have to take some risk in some other areas in our portfolio. So when I mentioned sustainment and I mentioned upgrades, we're going to have to focus on balancing those. The scout area is one we're going to accept some risk, and I expect to get another question on that there in a little bit. But we'll accept some risk in those areas to focus on that long-range investment to get a medium lift variant. And you know the medium lift is a utility, which we buy all across here, is all common in the Blackhawk, or a variance of it for the services. So we see that as the next generation. And all my brothers to my right and left are participating in that. So we see a lot of potential for a joint variant coming out of that effort.
Thank you, Congressman Reyes, for the question. We agree with General Crosby in his assessment of the future vertical lift efforts and our participation in that. But currently, the Air Force is pursuing, for the most part, off-the-shelf technologies, and R&D efforts are primarily aimed at integrating, again, commercial or not commercial off-shelf, but currently available off-the-shelf systems into the combat rescue helicopter. And that would have been the same in the case of the CVLSP that was canceled this year. Our R&D, this effort then in developing off-the-shelf capabilities and the integration will take us through the capabilities gaps into the 2030 timeframe, which brings us into that timeframe of the future vertical lift strategy. The Air Force is investing in several, in particular, degraded visual environment technology solutions, and we're leading the way in 3D landing zone technology development. One of the points I would have to make is that we only have 5% of the rotary wing fleet in the Air Force, and as such, our contributions to that R&D effort are not quite as great as the other services, and we definitely capitalize on the efforts of our brothers down the table. Thank you, sir.
Thank you all. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Loviando.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank the panel for being here today. I'd like to talk first about the Common Vertical Lift Support Platform, and I guess General Kane. The FY DOD budget included $52.8 million in funding for this program and proposed no money in FY 13. We now understand that the Common Vertical Lift Support Platform will not go forward, and the Air Force has instead decided to take used Marine Corps UH-1Ns destined for the boneyard and use the Common Vertical Lift Support Program funding to recondition these aircraft, which some say are just unable to meet the requirements as the Air Force needs them. The question is, wouldn't it be better use of the almost $53 million of the Common Vertical Lift Support Platform funding to introduce an aircraft that can meet the requirements of the mission, even if it is limited quantities for now, but to considering the future? And the second part of that is, additionally, without the acquisition resources available to satisfy this urgent and compelling need, as many of us see it, has the Air Force considered any more affordable alternatives, such as leasing aircraft, to accomplish this mission?
Thank you for the question, sir. The requirement for the helicopter, for the Common Vertical Lift Support Platform, for both the nuclear mission and the continuity of government mission here in the NCR has not changed. The requirement remains the same. So the current platforms still lack in capacity, speed, range, endurance, force protection, survivability capabilities. What we are doing right now is the Air Force, because of frankly some of the budget issues, we're taking what we're calling an acquisition pause, and it's going to give us an opportunity to take a look at potentially more cost-effective ways of filling the requirements for this important mission. What we're doing is we've started by looking at things like enhancing the security at the missile sites by enhancing hardening and surveillance capabilities. We're looking at the potential for changing the way the mission in the NCR is tasked, and we're looking at exploring other excess defense articles that might be modified into a platform that could satisfy that requirement better. In terms of the Marine Corps UH-1Ns, the 22 that you've spoken about, we currently do not have a plan to spend that CVLSP money, the $50 million, on modifying those airplanes. We are going to, when we accept those airplanes between 12 and 14, we will put them into a storage condition, and we're going to have to study them to determine what sort of modifications would be necessary to either make them viable to participate in the mission, to be used for spare parts, or what other disposition we would determine. In terms of the CVLSP money, we will have some potential requirements, as I mentioned in my opening statement, to do safety obsolescence, and then there'll be some equipment availability or diminishing manufacturing sources issues with the current fleet that will have to be mitigated. And that's still open for a decision in terms of whether some of that money might be used for the current fleet, but not to modify the aircraft that are being transferred from the Marine Corps.
So there's no discussion about leasing?
No, sir. I don't recall any discussions from the program office in terms of leasing as one of the options. But there's nothing to say that we couldn't explore that as an option along with all the others for meeting this in a more cost-effective way.
So essentially the money for the Common Vertical Lift Support Platform, that almost $53 million, is not going to go towards operational needs of the Air Force. It's going to just to wind down the program. Is that what I'm hearing?
The the $53 million would be either rescinded or returned to the Air Force for other operational requirements at this point. But as I mentioned, we are creating a proposal for use of some of the funding that could crashworthy seats, night vision capable cockpit equipment that could enhance the capabilities of the current fleet in the short term. Decisions on that have not been made.
Okay. Thank you, General. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. Mr. Kritz.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you, gentlemen, for being here, for your service to our country. General Crosby, based on the elimination of the SERPAs and the C-27Js, with the move to the Air Force and then for close support, now we're only going to be using C-130s, has the Army adjusted or taken into account in your vertical lift plan or in this budget request any changes that will be made because now the Blackhawks will be used? Is there any changing in the plan and usage of Blackhawks due to this loss of the close support?
No, sir. The changes, when we had the C-27 program, the Army resourced that and the program office, of course, was under my control to procure that system to do that immediate mission for the Army. The senior leadership of the Army and the Air Force got together and made a decision that was the Air Force mission. The Air Force agreed to take it, so we transferred that program to them. At that point, there was no funding or plan for the Black Hawk and Chinook to do any additional because we were going to have the C-27 to do the mission.
Right.
Now, having said that, we've always counted on our utility aircraft and our cargo aircraft to go into those airfields where a fixed wing can't get to. There are many places in Afghanistan that doesn't matter whether it's a Sherpa or a C-27 or a C-130, they're not going to get there. So some of that resupply is going to continue to be done with our Blackhawks and Chinooks, and that's always been part of the plan. So no adjustment there. There are some airfields, a small number, that the C-27 could get to that the C-130 can't, about 1%, I think, which is very negligible across Afghanistan. I'll let my Air Force brothers talk to more detail of that. But the bottom line is there are C-27s there today. There are C-130s there today doing that time-sensitive mission for us. But I'm not going to blow smoke. There are also missions over there that are being done by those Chinooks and Blackhawks because no fixed wing can get there. But
Congressman, I'll just add to General Crosby's remarks that the Air Force is committed to providing the resources required as asked for and tasked by the combatant commander. And we believe that the C-130 is capable of doing that mission. In some environmental conditions, we believe it is better than the C-27 from a capacity standpoint, from a power plant standpoint. As General Crosby mentioned, there are a very small number of fields that the C-27 can get to that the C-130 cannot. But we believe that we can meet any requirement and are standing by for any additional tasking from the theater as required.
Okay, so if I understand correctly, no one sees any change in the tempo of usage of Blackhawks and Chinooks to backfill where a C-27 may have been able to get in.
No, sir, that's correct, sir.
Okay, thank you. Two and a half years ago, Department of Defense Acquisition Technology and Logistics Leadership asked industry to self-form the Vertical Lift Consortium. Based on the department's experiences over the last 2.5 years, can any of you comment on what the results of this partnership are and how the VLC will be utilized for future vertical lift initiatives?
Sir, I'll jump on that one because the Army has been very heavily engaged in that. The consortium, as I understood it, when we stood that thing up, was because we see duplication out there. I mean, industry have been great partners. They've got independent research and development dollars they have. We have our S&T dollars. What we were trying to preclude is duplication where we had a bunch of people going after the same technologies. The other thing is we in the government, we don't do a lot of development, cutting-edge technology development. Our partners in industry, that's what they do. So we were wanted to bring them on to be advisors to guide us as we look at these enabling technologies we needed to go to the future to prevent us from going down a rat hole and getting after something that really wasn't achievable. So we brought them to be on as an advisory panel. There was no commitment to award contracts of scope or anything like that. It was more of an advisory panel. In that, in this future vertical lift group that we have that meets, and we're going to meet again, we're supposed to meet this week, it's been delayed a week, we're looking at that joint vertical lift medium that I mentioned. Those team members from the consortium sit on and participate as part of that team. This is not a government-only thing. It's a joint and industry team that sits and advises, and they brief each time we get together as part of that. We consider that very critical, especially as S&T dollars get even shorter, so that we can encourage them to invest their IR&D towards those same, because I'm not going to be able to go after all of the enabling technologies we need. Hopefully they will be able to pony up in some areas and help as well to get us towards that next hurdle, if you will. Does that answer your question, sir?
Yes. Yeah, well, and just to go one step further, we're 2.5 years in. Is there anything that can be identified as deliverable at this point that has been generated through this?
As a result, I believe this summer we'll have a result. We funded a couple of demos that are going to give us, that as a result of their help and the actual contract effort, we should come out with a performance specification of what we think this aircraft should be. We don't know. Some people are saying that we're, you know, it's going to be rotary wing. We don't know that. It may be a vertical lift. It may be a tilt rotor of some sort that we're going to go to. But based on the wind tunnel studies and the demonstrators that we've done and the input of this team, including the consortium, we hope to have a deliverable this summer of a specification that will guide us towards what our next step will be that we're going after. Does that make sense?
Yes. Thank you. So you said this summer. Okay. Changing gears, but again for you, General, the Army's budget requests $272 million for 34 Lakota light utility helicopters. As I understand it, the Army's current policy doesn't permit these helicopters to be deployed in non-permissive environments because of the 72's lack of defensive protection. Is the Army reconsidering this restriction on the Lakotas? And why not use them somewhere overseas like the Balkans or where the threat is low?
Sir, that's a great question, and it's one that's asked a lot by our industry partners. The LUH is, as you know, was bought, and it's what we consider a non-covered system. Therefore, we did not apply any aircraft survivability equipment to it. We did not do live fire. And the first question that comes in our mind of whether we allow this thing into a non-permissive environment is the safety of that aircrew.
Right.
And because we have not provided all those safety provisions, now we know what it would cost to do that. We've estimated it if the decision is made to go do that. But my understanding as an acquisition guy that procures and maintains, sustains these systems, the Army is not entertaining at this time any option to go forward and put it in a non-permissive environment. We are putting it in some pretty complex missions as far as doing the Border Patrol and working with the National Guard and Reserves doing that mission. But that is not considered a non-permissive environment. So with my understanding right now, the Army position is we are not pursuing to put this aircraft in anything but as agreed to initially in a permissive environment.
Thank you. Mr. Wilson.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank all of you for being here today. And General Crosby, I think because you're sitting in the middle, all the questions are coming your way. But I am concerned about the issue of American tax dollars being spent to procure Russian-made Mi-17 helicopters for the Afghani and Iraqi air forces. As colleagues in the Senate have pointed out, we are purchasing these from aircraft from a Russian company, Rosoboron Export, which is actively engaged in selling arms to the Syrian government, which is in the midst of a murderous campaign that's already claimed nearly 9,000 lives. Why are we continuing to purchase the Mi-17 instead of an American helicopter with two alternatives? First, I understand it's not complicated to teach a pilot to fly a similar aircraft. Why would we not purchase a similar American-made aircraft such as the S-61? And secondly, with the large amount of Alpha model UH-60s still in the American fleet, what is preventing us from transferring some of these aging aircraft to the Afghani and Iraqi air forces?
Sir, Sir, if I stall, can I keep my time down? Or I'm kidding.
Well, no. Hey, you're still in the middle, but anyway,
yes,
good
sir.
Luck.
Got it. Sir, that's a very tough question. I know one that everybody's wrestling with. We have to remember that the task that we've been given in Afghanistan and Iraq is to train those folks and equip them so that they can maintain and sustain their own military mission. The Afghanis have over 30 years of experience in MI-17s. For us to bring, and so this was a decision that was waylaid to us. It was a decision to look at how much time, cost, and effort would it be to introduce an American-made system. Part of the responsibilities that you charter me with as a PEO is to maintain and watch over the industrial base of this country. So I do wrestle with that question. But the task was not to procure a utility aircraft that would work at that altitude. It was to buy an MI-17 because that's what they already trained. Now, we have to remember the folks that we're training and we're equipping and working with over there, many of them can't read and write. And to introduce and then bring the complex systems that we have, and while the SH-61 and the UH-60 Alpha may seem pretty simple to us compared to an MI-17, they're pretty complex. The sustainment, the training base, all of those things associated would have to be introduced and new. So that was a decision process. Obviously, I didn't make that decision, but that was a decision process that was gone through when the Department of Defense and the State Department said, go buy MI-17s. Now, I understand the concern about dealing with the Rosenborn exports. I will tell you that by us dealing directly with them, the sanctions came down, that we're dealing directly with them, and you asked me, knucklehead, why are you doing that? Simply, sir, because we have U.S. soldiers flying in and in back and in the front of these airplanes, and we owe them the airworthiness and safety cognizance, and the only way that we could get that cognizance of those systems is to deal with them. If the decision is made by the leadership of this country not to do that, then we will adjust. But that was the thought process of why we are where we are. We think we have made great strides in providing safe systems for those soldiers to fly in and to train our allies in to fly that system. I hope that's answered your question. It's still tough to wrestle with.
It does, but from new allies that we have, whether it be the former East Germany, the Slovakia, Poland, Bulgaria, Vietnam, hopefully they might have access. Anyway, I just urge you to look at that. A final question is, I had the opportunity, the Marines gave me a really extraordinary flight on a MB-22 Osprey, and on a visit to Iraq, we landed on a soccer field in downtown Haditha. We were greeted by the mayor, the chief of police, city officials. It was extremely impressive for our allies. And also, I think a message to the other people, too, that we have capabilities. And I'm also aware that the MB-22 or the B-22, that the speed could be very helpful for wounded troops to give added capability for recovery. Is the Army planning to introduce B-22 Ospreys into the fleet?
At this time, sir, no. The Army is not planning to buy any MV-22s. The Air Force and their special ops do have some that provide a lot of that rapid response capability in the CSAR role. We use our medevac was the UH-60 and the HH-60 in the medevac role. And you know the hour that we have, that magical mile that we do to take care of those soldiers, we've been able to exceed that with the systems that we have. A little bit different focus, a little bit different mission for us than the Marine Corps. We can buy many more Blackhawks than we can for the cost of one MV-22. That's not a criticism of the MV-22. For what it does, it is absolutely the best one out there. It just doesn't fit in the mission set of what the Army does today.
Well, as a military parent with four sons serving the military, I just want the best equipment. It surely impressed me that we can land on any soccer or football field in the world and how that projects our military personnel. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. Ms. Tsongas.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank you all for being here to testify. As I've been to Afghanistan and Iraq, it's been my experience to fly on some of these rotorcraft, so it makes this discussion all the more real to me. But I have a question for I think anyone who wants to take it, and maybe that's all of you, but can you talk briefly about how our rotorcraft countermeasures are performing? And I can remember distinctly being in a Black Hawk into the sort of deep concentration that those who were tasked with flying it were engaged in to make sure we were safe. But can you talk about how these countermeasures are performing in Afghanistan, and in terms of R&D, what will be the game changer in developing the next generation of countermeasures to meet whatever threats we may be facing in the future? Who wants
to go
first?
I'll give General Crosby a break here. He's probably getting thirsty. Ma'am, right now our countermeasures are working very well. We're equipping, of course, the four deployed 53s and the 46s with the most capable AIRCM system that we've got now. But all of the systems that we look at putting on our aircraft, both forward firing flares, expandable chaff, radar warning receiver capabilities. I think the systems that we have now are working very well. We have R&D money against each of these aircraft to upgrade those systems as we pace the threat to include CIRCM and the JTAS system that's being developed by the Department of the Navy, which is another two-color system that's both IR and HIF radar warning. So I think the systems that we've got now are working. The systems that we're looking at in the future are probably what are going to be the game changers. And I think the game changer, if you will, for us is systems now that can be upgraded via software at a cost effectively that pace the threat. And I think that's the most important thing for us.
Ma'am, if I could add to that, General Roebling's absolutely right. But the one that keeps me awake at night is that hostile fire, the simple systems, the RPGs and the small arms. Those are the ones, the things he just talked about with the CIRCM and with the ATIRCM and the CMOS. Those are okay. Those do a great job. And those, as he said, we need to be upgrading because the threat is going to continue to evolve. But the one that makes us so vulnerable in the rotary wing, because we're operating so in such close proximity to those soldiers, are those unsophisticated things like rocket-propelled grenades and small arms fire. So we're pursuing, and I think the game changer is when we're going to be able to give the soldier and put on that aircraft something that identifies where that small arms is coming from. And we're looking at a couple of different technologies. One's an acoustic and one's a flash that will allow us to cue on it, and if nothing else, suppress it, which protects that aircrew long enough to get out of that vulnerable spectrum. When we can do that and put something reliable in their hands, that, I think, will be the next step, augmented with what General Roebling already talked about.
And where do you think we are in that process?
Very well along, ma'am. Frankly, we've got one that's that's a flash that we're demoing. I've got it on the Apaches that are going in on this next rotation. And if that proves out, then we'll have something, I think, that really will help protect them. The acoustic one is not quite as mature, but is not far behind it.
Great. Thank you.
Congresswoman, the Air Force H-860Gs and the CV-22s are some of the most survivable rotorcraft in DOD from our perspective. Our efforts to focus on radio frequency and infrared countermeasures, chaff and flares, and maybe most importantly, the integration piece of sensor and intelligence data and its presentation to the crew that allows it to do to avoid the threats in the first place. So I think that's one of the most important pieces in terms of game-changing capabilities. In terms of both platforms, we continuously pursue upgrades. We are implementing a hostile fire indicator on the HH-60, and anytime we have an opportunity to work jointly, we participate with the other services. A good example would be our LIRCM program, participating with the CIRCM in terms of lessons learned and technology transfer.
Thank you all for your testimony.
Thank you. Ms. Roby.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank you all for being here today. And General Crosby, as you know, my district is the home of Fort Rucker and the U.S. Army Aviation Center, and the issues that we're here talking about today are certainly vital to what's happening not just in my district, but the Army's Program Executive Office for Aviation located at Redstone. So thank you for being here. And my first question is regarding General Crosby mission planning, and I'm aware that the helicopter incidents were the third leading cause of fatalities in the Iraq war. And in Afghanistan in 2008, helicopter-related losses were the number one cause of deaths. And so weather-related issues, disorienting brownout conditions, engine failure, wire strikes, and flying into the terrain of which the pilot was unaware accounts for 80% of the losses. So what efforts is the Army and other services, if anybody else wants to weigh in, executing to improve the mission planning performance for rotary wing operations?
Well, thank you, ma'am. I appreciate the question. What you just described is operations, and what's causing those problems is operating in a degraded visual environment, what we call DVE. And anything we can do to minimize that impact. I will tell you the challenge within the mission planning, there are some that will tell you that we should use DTED data and GPS in order to do that, global positioning system. But their probable errors, combine those two together and you can be as much as 30 to 35 feet off. And when you're going into a landing zone with rocks, and that's not good enough. So what we're pursuing is some other technologies. I will tell you that within the Army, the three platforms that we don't worry about now but is the Block 3 Apache, the F model Chinook, and the M model Black Hawk, because we have integrated in their digital cockpits a degraded visual environment capability. And you see that the incidents with those aircraft have come way, way down. So our focus right now is on those legacy platforms, the A model, L model Black Hawks, the Block 2 Apaches, the Kiowas, and the D model Chinooks. And each of those we're looking at. One of them is a autonomous landing system called HALS that we're looking at embedding, and it's kind of a strap-on system that we put on the aircraft to automate that system to give them some cues. There's also a radar that we looks at that actually we can apply that looks through the sand and gives them the visual cues they need to land the aircraft. But the key of all of this, there was a great learning curve when we first in. It's not always materiel. There's also training and experience. And how do you mitigate things like this, and how do you prepare and set up and do roll-on landing, those kind of things to mitigate. All of those together is what's going to get rid of this issue. It's a mix of the training and of the degraded visual improvements.
Thank you so much, General. Does anybody else want to weigh in?
I'll just pile on a little bit and just say that the Marine Corps is looking at the same things and agree with General Crosby completely. It's not just the equipment. It's TTPs and how you train and how you figure those out. B-22 is a good example of how we've taken a system that really has the difficult in brownout-type conditions because of the size of those rotor blades on each side of the aircraft. When you go into a landing zone that's dusty, it's fully enveloped. So we have a GPS landing system in that aircraft. You can, you know, lock onto your intended landing point, hover at about 50 foot, and just push a button and take all the problems out from the pilot's point of view and bring it right down to a safe landing. Other types of systems in the CH-53, not quite that sophisticated, but all that help with brownout, and we look at with all the services on developing better systems in that direction.
Yes, sir.
Congresswoman, I'll add to the comments of my colleagues here that the Air Force is the executive agent on a joint capabilities technology demonstration led by our Air Force Researchers Lab out in Wright-Patterson Air Force Base that is examining what we're calling a three-dimensional landing zone capability. It'll provide a high-resolution display integrated into the flight wear and display to the pilots in the aircraft. That will allow us to better navigate through this degraded visual environment that we're discussing here. So along with the other services, we're actively pursuing capabilities in that regard as well.
Thank you all so much. And again, I appreciate your time and being here and your service to our country. And Mr. Chairman, I yield back.
Thank you very much. Of the 20 questions that we needed to ask in discharge of our oversight responsibilities, I'm happy to report that 13 of them have been asked, which is why I asked my questions last, hoping they will all have been asked. Mr. Kritz asked some questions about the C-47. I'd just like to ask General Crosby one follow-up question relative to that. Can you speak to the cost incurred in the C-47 in the past for missions that should or could have been executed by platforms such as the C-27J? Are you concerned that the burden on the Chinook and associated costs will be increased with the divestment of the C-27J?
Sir, I cannot speak to you and tell you what the cost differential is on the 47 today. I'm sure we could derive those numbers, but the missions, as I mentioned, it's very hard to differentiate when that aircraft, as you know, is a mission aircraft, is doing air assaults, is doing resupply, so many things, but it's going to areas that a C-27 or a Sherpa couldn't get through anyway. So it is a cargo helicopter, and that's what we bought it for. The C-27, as I said, is there today and supporting us. I am confident that the leadership of the United States Army and the United States Air Force have come together, and the Air Force has said, hey, this is our mission and we'll support you. I have no reason to doubt that my brothers in blue will be there when we need them.
Is not the 47 one of the most expensive airplanes we have to fly per hour cost?
It is expensive, sir. It drinks fuel. It's the biggest, it's the heaviest. But it is also, I think, very, very reliable, especially with the new F model, and we've driven down some of those costs. But yes, sir, it is probably the most expensive of the ones we have.
So is it not true that every time we have to use the 47 because the C-27J or a similar airplane was not available, that we have had considerably increased costs?
Yes, sir, but I can't look you in the eye today and tell you what those numbers are and how many missions we've done. The C-27s have not been there the whole time, so we have been flying the Chinooks doing that mission, but since they've been there, they have been executing that time-sensitive critical cargo mission for us. So that has eliminated some of that time, which that doesn't mean that aircraft's sitting. We have not seen a reduction in op tempo by them doing that mission, and that aircraft is being used for something else. As you know, we're flying all of our aircraft at 4 to 6 times the normal op tempo of what we normally experience. It's a credit to our soldiers that they're able to maintain and sustain that kind of readiness.
One of your fellow officers had noted that we're, and I quote him, flying the blades off the CH-47. Would you concur?
Sir, I would say we're flying the blades off of all of them. I will tell you that the op tempo plan for these aircraft in peacetime was about 14.7 hours a month. We're flying in excess on the Kaya was over 100 hours a month. The Chinooks and Blackhawks are in the 60 to 80 range. So we're flying the blades out of all of them. I have some concerns about the sustainability and the long-term strategy of all the fleet, which I've got some studies and some analysis looking at. So I wouldn't say just the 47 needs to be looked at. I think we need to be concerned about all of them.
NASA is the National Aeronautical and Space Administration. It appears that most of their focus is on space rather than aeronautical. One of their original chartered responsibilities was R&D in rotorcraft. I'm not aware that that they're doing much there. Have I missed something?
Sir, I will tell you that we do some studies and some analysis with them. It's not a great deal. There's a team at Langley that we use. In fact, it's an old comrade of mine from my old early acquisition days that we use, and they participate in our Joint Vertical Lift Consortium and help us guide us to the future. But are they there present and every day in my engineering design? No, sir.
I'd like to ask a question of the Navy. As you look forward, which of your helicopters will you be relying on primarily for search and rescue?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I think we're gonna see both the 60 Romeo and the 60 Sierra in that role. Sierra's our primary aircraft in search and rescue at sea.
These are 60s, correct?
Yes, sir, they are.
All right. Is not that plane pretty limited in range and dwell time? Wouldn't that be much better done by a medium lift helicopter with considerably more range and dwell time?
We think the Sierra has, when we're talking about search and rescue at sea, the Sierra is more than adequate for that mission. We certainly will be working with the future vertical lift as we looked in the future to see if we can make gains in that area.
As you look forward, which rotary wing aircraft will you be using primarily for medical evacuation.
We continue to contribute with our HH-60s in Iraq and Afghanistan on medical evacs when called upon in support of SOF.
Is it not true that the 60 is pretty limiting in terms of range and size? It really is, doesn't even come close to providing enough room for an emergency aerial emergency room, does it? Are we not using the 60 because we no longer have a medium lift helicopter that we should be using for both of these missions?
From the Navy standpoint, Mr. Chairman, I'd have to get back to you on why, but I think we will continue to look at that as we look at future capabilities and requirements for the medium lift.
Because both of these critical missions would be better accomplished with a larger aircraft with more dwell time, with more size, with a longer range. General Crosby, the Army Improved Turbine Engine Program envisions a significantly more fuel-efficient and powerful engine for the Black Hawk and Apache helicopter fleet, as well as the next generation of joint multiple-role helicopters. Can you please explain what measures the Army is taking in this acquisition strategy to ensure there is competition between the science and technology phase and into engineering manufacturing development?
Yes, sir. I appreciate the question. That is a great capability, and I'm here to tell you, let me go on record as stating that the demo thus far is demonstrating 30% increase in power and 25% reduction in fuel. That is absolutely huge if you put that across the entire fleet and the Army and then our brothers in the Navy and Marine Corps and the Air Force, again, applicable to all those fleets, and look into our future to be the power plant for our future system. The acquisition strategy as we go forward and transition this from S&T to a material acquisition program is to encourage that competition in throughout the EMD phase. That is part of our strategy. That is our plan. The only thing that will affect us, of course, is the affordability. If we aren't able to garner sufficient funds to maintain that through EMD, we would have to down-select earlier. But our plan right now is to carry two vendors through the EMD phase.
Mr. Reyes, do you have additional questions or comments?
Just a couple, but I'll take them for the record.
You take them for the record?
Yeah.
Okay. Let me ask a question about the 53K. Are we going to have a period of time where we will not have a heavy lift helicopter available to us because of the timeline in developing this helicopter?
No, sir. 53K right now is being developed for an IOC of 2019, and I believe right now we continue to keep CH-53 Echoes out to the end of that transition to fiscal year 23.
Okay, we've decided that we can extend their useful life until the K is ready.
Yes, sir. There will be some risk there as in all legacy aircraft, and we may, right now that plan is for 8 squadrons of CH-53 Echoes at 16 aircraft per squadron, and because we no longer make those aircraft as we lose them or the life of the aircraft goes down, what we'll do is reduce the PAA in the squadrons down to 14 and then 12. But the answer to your question is we'll have a heavy lift helicopter while that's being developed and transitioned.
Okay. Mr. Reyes.
Yeah, I just have one quick one for you, General Crosby. The Army Improved Turbine Engine Program, which envisions a significantly more fuel-efficient and powerful engine for the Black Hawk and Apache helicopter fleet, as well as the next-generation joint multi-role helicopter. Can you please explain what measures the Army is taking in the acquisition strategy to ensure that there is competition beyond the science and technology phase into the engineering and manufacturing development?
Yes, sir. And as again, what a great capability in the tech base that is demonstrating all of the improvements that we asked for. We're in the process right now, the project manager, of taking this from S&T, and we go through what we call a material development decision, which lays out the acquisition strategy for that program. Our intention, our plan, as we put that together, is to carry two vendors through the EMD phase to promote that competition beyond the S&T phase. The only thing that would restrict our ability to do that would be affordability, whether we have, can garner enough funds to do that.
Very good. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you very much. As we review your testimony and the question and answer period, I'm sure that we will have additional questions for the record and discharge of our responsibilities for oversight. Thank you all so much for your service and your testimony. The subcommittee stands in adjournment.